Thank you very much, Amy. Thank you for that kind introduction, and thank you all for being here today. I'd like to start my talk today with something that we all know. We are in the middle of what my colleague and friend Jay Winter called the memory boom, and clearly it's a memory boom. I mean, on April the 6th, in 2 weeks from now, commemorations of U.S. entry into World War I will be held here in the U.S. and also across Europe, so the intensity of this memory boom is due to the fact that the Great War was, as you know, a major catastrophe, and not only for the lost generation of 1914-1918, but also for most societies and for most families. World War I was not the war that ended all wars, a fact that resonates in today's conflicts in the Middle East, in Syria, in Iraq, and so forth. But the Great War changed the usual relationship with death and mourning. It changed our relationship with death and mourning, and it changed them forever. One of the best witnesses of this major transformation was Sigmund Freud, the father of two sons, Jean-Martin and Ernst, who had enlisted in the Austro-Hungarian army. So let me start with a public lecture that Freud gave in Vienna on February the 16th, 1915, on the emotional impact of war. This lecture, as you may know, was later published as Thoughts for the Times on War and Death. In the first part of his lecture, Freud examined what he called the disillusionment of the war, a sentiment that characterized the first months, I will say even the first weeks of World War I, when the generation of 1914 realized that the Great War, as it will later be called in 1915, was different from previous conflicts of the 19th century, or from previous conflicts of the early 20th century, and not only in degree, but also in nature. And in the second part of his lecture, Freud examined what he called the alteration in the people's attitude towards death. Or to quote Sigmund Freud, before 1914, people wanted to, quote, eliminate death from life. They wanted to hide the reality of death. But the war of 1914-1918, the Great War, brought it back on an industrial scale. Death could no longer be ignored as people were dying by the thousands. In 1914-1918, no family was spared. Millions of people, war widows, orphans, or parents of soldiers killing combat, spent the rest of their lives dressed in somber. The aged mourned the young. Parents mourned the loss of several sons. Women mourned the loss of a husband or a fiancé. Another indicator of this widespread grief was the omnipresence of memories of the dead in family conversations. In a short autobiography published in 1987, the French historian Raoul Girardet, born in 1917, testifies to this. And here's what he says. As for the dead themselves, they remained strangely present. They were the ones we heard mentioned almost daily in adults' conversations. A husband, a son, a brother, a cousin, killed in Champagne, killed in Vieparge, killed in Argonne. It was also their faces, such young faces, that we saw as soon as we entered a friend's house, on the table, on a chest of drawer, frozen in what was then the dignity of the ritual of having a photograph taken, smiling or thoughtful, with a short, well-trimmed moustache, sometimes hunched up in the stiffness of a uniform, but it was still brand new. We all know, from a demographic perspective, how deadly World War I was. Around 10 million soldiers killed, 2 million Germans, 1.8 million Russians, 1.3 million French. And to the dead of a Great War, as you know, one must also add all those combatants and civilians who died of the Spanish flu epidemic at the end of the war, which was probably two or three times actually more murders than the conflict itself. We all know these figures, right? But in my view, they mean nothing if we don't start by presenting them as individual and collective experiences of loss and mourning. So the challenge for us historians is to grasp the mourning process in its reality, the experience of mourning, something equivalent to what the German sculptress Käthe Kollwitz did when she made two granite statues representing her husband, Karl, and herself, mourning their 18-year-old son, Peter, who had been killed in Belgium near the city of Ypres in October 1914. With this sculpture, Käthe Kollwitz succeeds in, I think, expressing the universality of the grieving parents, a man and a woman, side by side, isolated rather than really united by the overwhelming experience of losing a son in combat. Representing the experience of mourning is also what the American painter Albert Herter did with his amazing mural entitled Departure, in French, Le départ des poilus d'août 1914, Departure of the Infantryman, August 2nd, 1914. And if you go to Paris, you'll see it. It's at the Gare de l'Est railway station. So this painting is actually a fascinating montage built around two moments. Of course, here, the mobilization of the summer of 1914, which represents a group of French soldiers, French infantrymen leaving for the front, and also the official entry of the United States into World War I that we will be commemorating in 2 weeks. Why? Why these two moments? Because the young man here at the center is Albert Herter's eldest son, Everett Herter, himself a painter, who volunteered not in the summer of 1914, but in April 1917, and was killed on June the 13th, 1918, at the age of 24. The woman in white, at far left here, is Everett Herter. So the woman here on the left is Everett's mother, and the man at the right hand here is Albert Herter himself, a self-portrait with a bouquet of flowers. Everett Herter, of course, as you can see here, is the principal central focus of the representation of the composition. And at first glance, he seems to embody the spirit of 1914. He looks triumphant, he looks unconcerned. But if you look more closely, you may notice that his arms form a cross, and that actually is presented as a Christ-like sacrificial figure. So, and that's very interesting too, his father here and his mother here are represented as elderly people, certainly older than we will have been in 1914, because in 1914, Albert Herter, the painter, was only 43 years old. So, like Käthe Kollwitz, like Karl Kollwitz, they are mourning the loss of their son, with a father carrying a bouquet of flowers, and upon heart, and the mother joining her hands together as if she were in prayer. This triangular trinity of the father, the mother, and the departing son reveals the true meaning of Herter's painting. It's not an idealized representation of France's entry into World War I, but a painting about death, a painting about loss, a painting about grief. With this painting at the Gare de l'Est in Paris, with a sculpture of the mourning parents at Vlaatlo in Belgium, Albert and Adel Herter, Käthe and Karl Kollwitz suggest a family that includes us all. The most intimate here is also, in many ways, the most universal. Unfortunately, historians are not sculptures. I'd like to be a sculptor, not a sculptor. Historians are not artists. So how do we, as historians, study private grief and collective mourning. I will start by addressing a, so that's still the painting, a general question. Who were the people in mourning and how many of them were there? So that's what I call the communities in mourning. The first thing I want to say is that the scale of the communities in mourning in 1914-1918 is the most impossible for us to imagine. And this is, I think, the real difference between the US and Europe, something that Americans should know and remember about World War I. In the US, World War I, and like World War II actually, is not written in family history. It's not written in most families' histories. Right. The U.S. were at war for 16, 17 months. The U.S. Army lost 53,400 men in combat, which is less than the number of U.S. soldiers and officers who died of illness in the conflict. The impact of the Great War on European societies is radically different. 10 million Europeans died in the Great War. Between 30% and 50% of these 10 million men have no known grave. That's the same percentage of people who died of 9/11 with no trace whatever. Historians estimate that if the extended family of relatives was included for each soldier, the figure would be close to 39 million. When we think of collective mourning in 1914, 1918, and afterwards, we must think in terms of a social catastrophe affecting all levels of society, from the intimate circle of the parents and family members to the more distant circle, the friends and colleagues. And this was especially true when a specific battle had a catastrophic impact on a local level. Think, for instance, of how the news of the first day of the Battle of the Somme, July the 1st, 1916, was received in a city, say, like Manchester, where thousands of young men, whose families sometimes were neighbors, living in the same streets, were killed on the same day. The first circle of mourning, so to speak, was composed of the soldiers themselves. This is something we tend to forget, but even a victorious army like the French, the British, or the American armies in 1918 were armies in mourning, mourning the dead as much as rejoicing for victory. This could be observed as early as November the 11th, 1918, after 11 a.m. What did the soldiers do at the time of the armistice? They first tried to find the bodies, or actually what was left of these bodies, on the no man's land. They buried them and decorated with flowers the wooden crosses like this one that marked the temporary graves. Those who had lost friends, and most of them, all of them, actually lost friends in combat, brothers or comrades in arms, often expressed what will later be diagnosed as the survivor's syndrome, a notion invented only in the 60s by the US psychiatrist William Nederland, and it can be summed up like as followed: they are dead, I am alive, they have therefore given their lives for me. This first circle of mourning, the small primary groups, worked as a kind of symbolic family at the front, a substitute for the soldiers' relatives who can be identified as the second circle of mourning. And the second circle of mourning was composed of the parents, the grandparents, children and wife, but also of a larger family, like, you know, uncles and aunts, cousins, nieces, and if you was basically everybody as someone who lost in World War I. In 1914-1918, probably for the first time, world history became family history. The New Zealand writer Catherine Mansfield lost her younger brother on October 7th, 1915, and she described this tragedy as, quote, the most severe emotional crisis of her life. And I quote her, "On the mantelpiece in my room stands my brother's photograph. I never see anything that I like or hear anything without the longing that he should see and hear too. I had a letter from his friend again. He told me that after it happened, he said over and over again, 'God, forgive me for all I've done.' And just before he died, he said, 'Lift my head, Kitty. I can't breathe.'" Mourning multiple deaths was not exceptional in 1914, 1918. This experience had a devastating impact on the survivor's emotional life. What can you expect from the future when several members of your family and most of your friends have been killed? Here's, for instance, what the pacifist writer Vera Brittain wrote in the 1920s. She had lost her fiancé, Roland, a brother, and several members of the family, also several friends, actually, in the Great War. "Only gradually did I realize that the war had condemned me to live to the end of my days in a world without confidence and security, a world in which every dear personal relationship will be fearfully cherished under the shadow of apprehension, in which love will seem threatened perpetually by death, and happiness appear a house without duration, built upon the shifting sands of chance. I might perhaps have it again, but never again should I hold it." Beyond this second circle of mourning, there is a third one, which is actually more difficult to describe and to study, made up of distant family members and friends. And I like this picture, which is a picture of a group of students from the École Normale Supérieure, my old school, where, you know, it's a group of students of 1912, I think, so just before the outbreak of World War I. The students of the École Normale Supérieure in Paris lost 239 friends in 1914-1918, which is one-third of all students and alumni who served in the war. The survivors, because in that case, that's really the word, survivor, not just veterans, but survivor. So the survivors wrote short but very personal and very moving biographies for the Ecole's yearbook. And take this obituary written by the novelist, very good novelist actually, Maurice Genevoix, for one of his friends killed at the age of 25 in January 1915. "We had fought often during those long months of war, and each engagement had created voids around me. All the good friends at the beginning whom I had chosen what lightened my hours and to whom I wanted to give back the strength they had given me had fallen, one after the other, all of them, until I was alone in a crowd of indifferent men. And among those whose support I wished for to make this cult of her dead more fervent was Benoit, dearest to my heart and most valued friend. I said to myself, he at least will be saved. And I believed it. Then one morning, in the white hospital room, the mail order sent me a card, and on this card I read, 'Benoit is dead.' I felt an all-encompassing and crushing sorrow. I could not understand it. It did not make sense." Genevoix's reaction to his friend's death leads us to the second point I would like to discuss with you today, which is the specificities of grief and collective mourning in 1914-1918. I think we must start, of course, with something which is obvious but very important, this idea of the lost generation. For the first time, think about that, for the first time in European history, probably for the first time actually in world history, death in combat reversed the normal succession of generations, and not on a limited scale, rather on the scale of a whole generation, la génération perdue, the lost generation. In the British case, for instance, 30% of men aged between 20 and 24. I always tell that to my students, of course. 30% of all men aged between 20 and 24 in 1914 were killed in the war. There were often feelings of shame, feelings of guilt towards the younger men who were almost exclusively bearing the burden of war and death. Western societies as a whole suffered from an absence of defensive strategies when they were confronting with the mass killing of a generation of 1914. The famous sociologist Emile Durkheim literally died of grief only 1 year after his son's death. André had been the pride and hope of Emile Durkheim, who had seen him as his successor in the academic world. And Durkheim became obsessed, totally obsessed, with his son's death in combat. The image of his son haunted him. This is what he writes. The image of his exhausted child alone at the side of the road in the midst of night and fog that seized me by the throat, unquote. The sociologist, very famous sociologist of the time, retreated into silence and insisted that the name of André, his son, not be mentioned in his presence. He died on November 15, 1917, at the age of 59. Even many decades after World War I, this reversal of the normal succession of generations was still seen as a major transgression by the survivors of the Great War and their descendants. Take the French writer Albert Camus, born in November 1913. His father, Lucien, was 29, and he looks so young here, was 29 in August 1914, Lucien Camus. On the outbreak of the war, he joined his unit of Zouave, which is a name for an Arab word for military recruits from North Africa, because he lived in Alger, and he was severely wounded during the Battle of the Marne in September 1914. Lucien Camus was evacuated to a hospital at Saint-Brieuc in Brittany, and he died 4 weeks later. In Alger, his wife, Catherine Camus, received the official notification, which she was unable to read because she was illiterate, followed by fragments of shell removed from her husband's body. In 1953, the 40-year-old Albert Camus made a pilgrimage to the cemetery in Brittany where his father lay. He found the grave in the first row of the military section at the Saint-Michel Cemetery in Saint-Brieuc, and there he read the date. And this is a beautiful passage from Albert Camus' last novel, Le Premier Homme, a copy of which, as you may know, was found in a briefcase near the car in which the novelist died in January 1960 at the age of 46. So that's Albert Camus, and that's this. Really, I highly recommend this amazing book, The First Man by Albert Camus. So here's what he writes. 1885-1914, and automatically, he, Camus himself, did the arithmetic, 29 years old. Suddenly, he was struck by an idea that shook his very being. He was 40 years old. The man buried under that slab, who had been his father, was younger than he. And the wave of tenderness and pity that once filled his heart was not the stirring of a soul that leads the son to the memory of a vanished father, but the overwhelming compassion that a grown man feels for an unjustly murdered child, something he was not in the natural order. And in truth, there was no order, but only madness and chaos when the son was older than the father. So that's, I think, a very, very interesting idea, this idea of the reversal of the normal succession of generation. But there's another specificity, which is dying alone, which leads to kind of ritual crisis during the Great War and afterwards. One of the most striking fears experienced by the soldiers of the Great War was of dying alone in the midst of a no man's land, abandoned by their comrades because of the violence of the battle. And you'll tell me, well, it's a very common experience in wartime. But here, in the case of World War I, it must be seen specifically in light of both the extreme violence of the battle and also the religious rituals that were still very, very important before the outbreak of the war. Without a truce for stretcher bearers, or because the short unofficial truces were too precarious, soldiers who fell wounded between the lines lay dying for hours, sometimes days. According to the military historian John Keegan, for instance, one third of the 20,000 British soldiers and officers who died on the Somme on July the 1st, 1916, so the first day of the Battle of the Somme, might have been saved had the wounded soldiers been aided as they would have been a half century earlier. No truce for stretcher bearers and changes, of course, everything. So for civilians on the armed front, imagining their loved ones dying in an almost animalistic solitude was unbearable. Traditionally, in most European societies, the funeral process involved, as you know, the gathering of family members and friends, family unity, family supports, rituals, religious ceremonies. The Great War abolished these rites of separation that went along with the first moments of loss and put an end to all the procedures in preparation for mourning in the most violent and brutal way. And this leads me to the third specificity of death and mourning in 1914-1918, the absence of bodies. It changes everything. For the families, without a body to bury, there was no ceremony, and therefore no traditional rites to perform. We all know how difficult it is to start the mourning process without having seen, touched, or kissed the body of the dead. But this is something thousands and thousands of families actually experienced during and after World War I, an absence of closure for thousands and thousands of families. Nobody, no service, no family and friends to provide comfort at the grave. World War I left loved ones in a state of limbo, in need of some kind of reassurance about the spiritual welfare of the departed. Why? For two reasons, actually. First, the complete destruction of between 30% and 50% of those killed in the Great War. Very large pieces of shrapnel could actually slice a man in half. Direct heats from shells could literally pulverize the body, leaving no remains that could be later identified. Listen, for instance, to Paul Dubrul, a French Jesuit and a veteran of the Battle of Verdun in February 1916. When one heard the whistle in the distance, one's whole body contracted to resist the two excessively potent vibrations of explosion. And at each repetition, it was a new attack, a new fatigue, a new suffering. Under this regime, the most solid nerves cannot resist for long. Perhaps the best comparison is that of seasickness. Finally, one abandons oneself to it. One has no longer even the strength to cover oneself with one's pack as protection against splinters, and one scarcely still has the strength to pray to God. And that's the point. To die from a bullet seems to be nothing. Parts of our being remain intact. But to be dismembered, torn to pieces, reduced to pulp, this is a fear that flesh cannot support, and which is fundamentally the great suffering of the bombardment. But there is another reason for the absence of dead bodies, which is often less known. In 1914-1918, bodies were almost never returned to the soldiers' families, unlike the quick repatriation of bodies to the U.S. from the Korean War, the Vietnam War, and later from Iraq and Afghanistan. In the case of the British soldiers, British officers actually, not the British soldiers, the British officers, it was the uniform and the personal belongings that were sent to the family, serving as a kind of symbolic substitute for the dead body. There I retain again this young student at Oxford on the war's outbreak in August 1914, who lost her fiancé in 1915, two of her friends in 1917, and finally her brother in 1918. When her fiancé Roland was killed on December the 23rd, 1915, he was a young officer, age 20. You know, see the ages, it's you see, 20, 23, 24, 25. He was age 20 and was fighting near Lens in northern France. On January the 13th, 1916, Roland's personal belongings were sent home. And here's what the Albertine writes about that in Testament of Youth. I arrived at a very opportune, though very awful moment. All Roland's things had just been sent back from the front, and they were all lying on the floor. I had no idea before of the aftermath of an officer's death, or what the written kit, about which so many letters have been written in the papers, really meant. It was terrible. Mrs. Lytton and Claire were crying as bitterly as on the day we heard of his death. There were his clothes, the clothes in which he came home from the front last time. Another set rather less worn, and other clothing and accessories of various descriptions. Everything was damp and worn and simply caked with mud. All the sepulchres and catacombs of Rome could not make me realize mortality and decay and corruption as vividly as did the smell of those clothes. As for the French soldiers, their bodies remained on the battlefield, until the French government gave permission to repatriate them. But this did not happen before a special decree was passed in 1920. Why did it take so long for French families to get their loved ones' bodies back home for private burial? Nobody knows. But the enormous amount of energy many French families spent to have this decree finally signed shows in itself the psychological sufferings caused by distance and prolonged absence. Take the French politician Louis Barthou, actually he was prime minister in 1913, who spoke before the National Commission on Military Burials on May the 31st, 1919, so really, you know, almost more than 1 year after the end of the war, when several months after the end of the war, when the government still opposed the return of the soldiers' remains on the grounds, but not all families had a body to bring back. So here's what he says. Fine, it's all very well that our children will be equal in death, but I don't see what principle of equality requires that a hard and fast rule be established as far as families are concerned. There is my son, who was killed in 1914. You know, again, it's 1919, May the 31st, 1919. Was killed in 1914, 5 years ago. He's in Tom. His mother and I are waiting for him. And because offers have not been found, you tell me that you forbid me to take my son and bring him to the Père Lachaise Cemetery in Paris. Well, I tell you that you have no right to do this. You explain it by saying that hundreds of thousands of soldiers have been killed and you have not identified them, but mine was. You speak of identification. Well, mine was identified. Of the transportation shortage, but I can bring back my son on my own without asking anything of the government. This is not what I understand by equality, and I think the proposed government bill is a mistake. That's why I, for my part, won't accept it. Now, you have to imagine the return of these 240,000 bodies exhumed and returned to their families between 1920 and 1923. You have to imagine the demobilization of the dead in post-World War France. Thousands of trains loaded with tens of thousands of coffins crisscrossing the French territory. The last episode of an endless transition from war to peace and a symbolic closure for the Great War. With a number of missing in action, the mass death of the younger generation, not to mention the fact that a number of civilians died of a Spanish flu epidemic or died of hunger in the case of the Germans and Austro-Hungarians living under the Allied blockade. For all these reasons, the mourning process after World War I was incredibly painful and difficult, and gave birth to a new commemorative activity, new languages, new rituals, which I would like to briefly present now in my third and last part of this lecture, the languages of mourning in post-World War I Europe. My point, of course, is not to present you the role of commemorative activity after World War I. It would be impossible and useless. I would rather focus on two major cultural processes that deal with the transformation of personal grief into collective mourning. The first one is what I call the nationalization of mourning. Put differently, the emergence of a collective memory of mass death and the creation of new symbolic spaces after the war. The first example, which is probably the most striking one, is the fact that the killing fields themselves, the battlefields, became commemorative sites through a network of military cemeteries, landscaped memorial parks, or large battlefield monuments. War tourism, that was the word used at the time, war tourism, you see all this group of civilians visiting the battlefields as early as 1919, actually, when it was still extremely dangerous actually to go there. War tourism appeared at the same time and became extremely popular in the interwar period, even for families living very far from the front, the U.S., this amazing picture of three Gold Star mothers and their pilgrimage to France in the early 1920s. But there were also many mothers, widows, families who came from Canada, from Australia, even from New Zealand, and also for German families as well, who even after the defeat of Germany after 1918, who visited these battlefields. Making, I think, the journey to the Western Front was important for many of them, especially for the families of the missing in action. Visiting the battlefields allowed some of them to move on, probably, and to start what Freud called the labor of mourning. Others claimed that they could almost feel the presence of the dead, the presence of their dead, and build a community in mourning with other grieving families. A number of ceremonies were organized to contribute to the dead, especially on Armistice Day or on July the 1st, in the case of the British Army on the Somme. But there is more. Tourists and pilgrims took pictures of the battlefields and war cemeteries. They brought back sometimes material souvenirs of the trenches, earth, or fragments of shell from the battlefields. So these new sites of memory were represented also on objects. This one is very kitschy. It's the ossuary of Duomo representing the tray, so we'll use that for coffee or tea. But anyway, it was represented on a tray in the 30s, and the ossuary here that you see. I don't know if you've been to Verdun, but Duomo, but the ossuary itself was built in 1932, and it contains the remains of at least 130,000. Unidentified combatants. And the cemetery here is composed of 16,000 tombs and crosses. So after 1918, the war and its traumatic memory entered into people's home and took up residence. The second example of this development of this nationalization of mourning is the development of war memorials. And we all know, of course, that the war memorials were not invented in 1918. I mean, the war memorials had already been built after the American Civil War, for instance, or after the Franco-Prussian War of 1870-1871. What changed with World War I was the number of memorials. War memorials were built in almost every village, in parks, in gardens, in schools, in universities, in workplaces across the world. More memorials were built after World War I than after any previous conflict in the history of the Western world. In the 20s, every country had its own tradition. The size was different, the style was different, the design, the iconography were different. But all memorials had something in common. They tried to give an interpretation of the war. They tried to give a meaning to catastrophe that did not make any sense. And the presence of war memorials in almost every village gave, and still gives today, a sense of national unity. This sense of national unity manifested itself through the ceremonies on November 11th, especially in France and in Britain. For the last generation, an entity was created that followed the rules of classical tragedy, unity of time, every November the 11th at 11 a.m. everywhere. Unity of space, the war memorial. Unity of action, the commemorative ceremony, naming the dead. And the commemorative practice of the 1 minute silence or the 2 minute silence in Britain. The act of naming the dead is important. Naming the dead is probably one of the major legacies of the Great War. After such a devastating experience like World War I, memorials served as a kind of transitional space dedicated to the memory of each individual soldier killed in the war. War memorials served as a substitute for the graves of the absent and the missing. In a way, the inscription of the names here, the inscription of names on war memorials can be interpreted as an act of resistance to totalizing discourses about mass death. Every soldier was remembered individually. Every soldier had to be remembered individually. Last example of the nationalization of mourning, the commemorative invention par excellence of the Great War, the unknown soldier, with the two exceptions of Russia and Germany, the cult of the unknown soldier appeared almost at the same time in Paris and London, in Washington and Brussels, Prague and Belgrade in 1922, and also Ottawa in 2000. On November the 10th, 1920, the unknown soldier's coffin arrived in Paris by special train from Verdun, where he had been chosen among eight others. The coffin was placed for one night here at the Place d'Enfer Rochereau, a symbolic place named after a heroic French commander who served during the France's disastrous defeat of the Franco-Prussian War of 1870-1871, so thus symbolizing the French revenge over the Germans. The next day, after the brief ceremony at the Pantheon, the coffin was brought to the Arc de Triomphe, which commemorated, as you know, Napoleon's victory. It had been draped, you can see that on the picture, with the French flag, and placed on the gun carriage here, surrounded by disabled veterans. But this is my point. The coffin was not only accompanied by veterans, it was accompanied by a fictitious family. A war widow, a mother and father who had lost, well, not related, a mother and a father who had lost a son, and a child who had lost his father. It was as if each French man or woman was to adopt a non-soldier as a member of his or her own family. There's first this kind of nationalization of mourning, but there's also the second major cultural process, a spiritualization of mourning. And this is really the end of my lecture. I would like to examine one emblematic example and end my lecture with it. This is the story of this young man, Maurice Gallet, a young officer cadet, age 22, who died in Bouchaven, on the Somme on September 20th, 1916. Maurice was sent on a reconnaissance mission, and he was just back from leave, so he probably lost his way and he was shot by a German patrol. He was the only child of Berthe and Auguste Gallet, who owned a little factory in Creil, close to Paris. It's probably 1 hour from Paris. He was unmarried. He had only a few relatives. I mean, his immediate family included only seven people. His death, as you can imagine, was experienced as a terrible emotional shock for all of them. It actually took six months, before Maurice Gallet's parents received the confirmation that their son had been killed. He was first considered missing in action, and his body was later identified in the spring of 1917. Berthe and Auguste Gallet could not wait until the end of the war to see the place where the son had been buried. So despite the obvious danger, despite, of course, the restrictions imposed by the military authorities, they drove to Bouchavennes as soon as they could, and they took pictures of the temporary grave. In the early 20s, Berthe Gallet, the mother, decided to transform Maurice's bedroom into a sort of mausoleum. Some ground from the battlefields was brought back to Creil, along with fragments of shells and other material souvenirs of the Great War. Behind a cabinet's window, Maurice Gallet's uniform, his uniform of 1914, and his ruby red pants. You can see here some pictures representing the young man, who was age 20, as I said, and the tricolor cocards here, which is a national symbol that had been placed on the wooden cross to mark the temporary grave on the battlefield. But that's not all. In this room, progressively transformed into a chapel, Maurice was presented as a saint, what saved France. And as his grandmother wrote in a prayer, l'univers tout entier, the whole universe. Maurice's personal belongings were described by Berthe Gallet, the mother, as some religious relics. Until her death in 1927, Maurice Gallet's grandmother went every day, to his room and recited the prayer she had composed for him, thanking God for having given her such a courageous grandson. When did the mourning process end? Paradoxically, in the last few years, we have witnessed a new emotional investment in the conflict. The third and the fourth generations, the generations of the veterans' grandchildren and great-grandchildren, are more and more conscious of the importance of the Great War in the history of the 20th century. The First World War tends to be ever more present, as you know, in the minds of successive generations. Many historians argue, and that's something very interesting, that this renewed interest is related to the unfinished process of mourning. In the late 20s, after the death of Maurice's father, Berthe Gallet, the mother, decided to donate the house, her house, their house, so that it could be transformed into a museum. It's still there. It's still the Musée Gallet-Juillet, Museum Gallet-Juillet. She was living in a small house just opposite the Musée Maurice Gallet, founded in the 30s, and she died in 1956. Now, there is my point. Was this transformation of the house into a museum a way to show that the mourning process was over? Or on the contrary, a way to prolong it eternally because it's still the Musée Maurice Gallet? It's very difficult, of course, to answer such a question, but in any case, after so many years, Maurice's room, this room, remains unchanged, a private chapel, a site of mourning in a public museum. Thank you.
All right, thank you all for coming, and thank you, Dr. Caban. If you have a question, please raise your hand, and either myself or Wesley will pass the microphone to you. We are recording this, so make sure we can hear everybody.
I have a question about about the monument, the first one where the family was and perhaps the little children.
Yes.
And the soldier, it looked from here like he was in a soldier's wounded position.
Yeah,
like
probably even killed. Yeah.
And the other question is the picture of the guy on the train and his mother and his father, the Trinity thing. Uh-huh. From here, his gun looked like it was, maybe he was shooting it off in exuberance or something. But when you showed the close-up of it, there are flowers sticking out of the barrel of his gun, which is hugely significant.
Of course.
I just kind of missed that.
Yes. So the first point, I can show you if you want, again, the have a picture. So that's, give me 2 seconds. I think it's been the first part of, oh, here. So that was it, right?
Right.
Yeah. So that's okay. So that's very interesting memorial. It's actually the only one I know representing a group like that. Usually you have a widow. You sometimes have a widow with one orphan. But it's very rare to have a widow probably with, I will say, maybe sisters or aunts, and also at least two children. So it's very quite unusual to have this large group of a large family group. And it's a monument in the south, Hérault, which is near Montpellier, in the southern part of France. So that's interesting because also what is very unusual is to have a representation of a dead body. You know, most of the time it's a representation of a kind of triumphant poilu, a French infantryman, sometimes with a flag or with national emblem. So it's very interesting to see that in that case this circle of mourning families is represented. So that's the first point. I don't know if it answers your question, but
the train and the gun.
Okay. Yeah. So that's the first. Okay, so here it is. So, as I said, it's a mural that is held at the Gare de l'Est. So you are interested in that, right? Okay, so that's interesting because it's how the mobilization of the French was represented until basically the 1970s. The first real turning point is a very, very important study by Jean-Jacques Becker, who was a major historian of World War One. We did his dissertation in the 60s and 70s, and published his dissertation in 77 about the mobilization in France. And what he shows is that, unlike what is represented here, which is the flowers, as you say, in the barrel of a gun, there's an expression in French, we say, la fleur au fusil. La fleur au fusil, and that's it, exactly. La fleur au fusil, and of course, la fleur au fusil means enthusiasm. You know, you go to war, as if it's like, kind of crusade, or you know that it will be over anyway in a couple of months, a couple of weeks. You know, most of these people, young men, could not imagine actually the reality of World War One. We could, anyway, imagine that, something, an example I give often, on August the 22nd, 1914, 27,000 French soldiers were killed on one day. It's the equivalent of all the losses of the Franco-Algerian War from 1954 to 1962 in one day. It's the worst catastrophe in French military history in one day. So it was impossible to imagine. So what is very interesting is that in the 30s, mobilization was still presenting as, the kind of enthusiasm, and we all know now that it was different. But again, my point was to show that behind this representation. Oh, okay, I did something which I. I don't know. Behind this representation of the spirit of 1914, if you want, represented again. I think the painting was made in 1926 or 1927. Behind that, the real meaning of the painting is loss and mourning. And I made a point about the couple and how they mourn the loss of their son. Thank you for your questions. Thank you.
The 27,000 dead in one day.
Yeah.
Was that in a trench warfare situation or mobile warfare?
It was mobile warfare.
Can you describe it?
Yeah, it was mobile warfare. It was the Battle of the Frontiers. It was in Charleroi. It was really the beginning of the war. Because basically the transition from mobile warfare to trench warfare is more of the fall of 1914. So yes, that's really, basically, I mean, it's of course very difficult ways to explain the number of that. But one of the reasons is actually, that. I mean, clearly the ruby red pants did not help, having, this uniform for the infantryman, which seems totally, So absurd now, but it's part, I think, it was seen as part of French national identity, really. I mean, it was actually invented in the 1830s, and there were debates just before the outbreak of World War I in 1913 at the Chambre des députés, and I remember I read these debates, and one deputy said, "No, I mean we can't change that. The ruby red pen. That's France. That's the definition of France. So that's part of a national honor. But of course, I mean it had a devastating impact, of course, on the French National Army in 1914. And as you know, the uniform itself changed only in 1915. Other questions? Yes, sir. I think you, yeah, the microphone.
Today, the U.S. has obligations of mutual defense under NATO that I would like to hear how those might compare to the mutual defense treaties that were such a big factor in World War One.
Well, it's very different. There was no obligation for the U.S. to enter World War One in 1917. It was a national debate, very long debate. You know, the thing about I think the way to answer your question is that, as you know, we all think that the sinking of Lusitania was a turning point for the U.S. opinion. You know, it was the spring of 1915. It took at least, 2 years for the U.S. to enter World War I. So, no treaty, of course. But I think what it shows at the end is the complexity of this country, the complexity of its nation. You know, think about the U.S. in 1917. Composed of so many immigrants from many places. Some of them, of course, were related to Germany, for instance. You know, it was the largest community of immigrants. You know, I teach now in the Midwest, and clearly there's a neighborhood in Columbus called German Village. And that was one of the problems, of course, tensions, very strong tensions, of course, in the country prior to 1917 and after. So that was a choice, that was a political choice, with debates that started as early as 1914. As you know, Theodore Roosevelt, for instance, was really in favor of a stronger involvement, and Wilson was not. So, I mean, that's a very, it's a very long, it should be a very long answer to question. I mean, I don't have time for that, but clearly it's not comparable with NATO. It's a different world. It's only a choice. And it's related, I think, it's a way, of course, when we think of these doughboys arriving in France, it was also a renewal in many ways of the Franco-American friendship. You know, what Pershing does when he arrives for the first time on the French soil, he goes in Paris and goes to the cemetery of Picpus and gives his famous speech in honor of Lafayette. So I hope that there will be, ceremonies in the next months or so to celebrate that. We'll see, but that's a very important moment, of course, in the relationship between France and the U.S.
We have a question. Yeah.
Yes.
Can you give us an idea of the number of killed in action, not total casualties, but killed in action from the major countries that were involved in the war?
Okay, yes, thank you for your question. So in the case of the U.S., that's 53,400 men, a bit less than 54,000 killed in action. But if you take those who were killed in accident or illness, you know, the Spanish flu was disastrous for the U.S. Army. In that case, it's more 100,000 dead. In the case of now, the number, I mean, as a war, it's 10 million men killed in World War One, but the Germans, it's 2 million, 1.8 for the Russians, 1.3 for the French. The point is not only to have these numbers, but also to see the percentage. If you compare, of course, the number of people, the soldiers killed, and the population. In that case, Serbia is probably the country in which World War One inflicted the most losses. I think it's, I don't remember exactly the percentage, but it's a huge percentage of the general population. What is very interesting, I think, in terms also of losses, it's the fact that it's a major transition in the history of war, 19th century, 20th century. For the first time, you have less soldiers and officers who die of illness. You know, think of the Civil War. Most soldiers and officers died actually of illness, epidemics, and things. Of course, the major turning point with World War I is that most soldiers die of combat. The Americans being amongst the exceptions, but they arrived quite late, and that's. But again, if you think of the Americans, I mean, they fought for so they really started fighting in the spring of 1918. So I think March, April to November, 53,000 soldiers and officers killing about, that's quite a lot. I think, I mean, the, on average, it's around 900 soldiers and officers killed every day, and slightly less than the number of officers and soldiers killed in the French army at the same time. So, I mean, really, for the time we spent on the Western Front, it has a huge impact really on the American army. So I don't know if it answers your question, but clearly, it's... there are different ways of seeing the losses, the American losses in World War I, but if you take the number of months, that clearly the impact was very strong.
We have time for one more.
Yes, thank you. Yeah.
The battle where the 27,000 French were killed.
Yep.
How many Germans were killed?
Wow, I don't know. I think there were less German soldiers. I shouldn't know the number exactly. It's in Charleroi, but it's less German soldiers were killed in Charleroi than the French.
So the French were attacking.
The French were attacking, but you know, there are several factors. But it less, yeah, it had a less impact on the. It's a very good question on the German. I can check that for you if you want to send me a message. But it had less impact on the German army. The Battle of the Frontiers was absolutely disastrous for the French army. You know, we have to think about that again. I mean, I wrote this book on August 1914. I mean, for many reasons. I mean, the war could have ended like 3 weeks after the outbreak of World War I, because I mean. Paris, France was invaded. Paris was saved. Like, you know, it was almost a miracle. I mean, the Battle of the Marne. So, and really, with these disastrous casualties of the Battle of the Frontiers, it's probably one of the worst months in the history of World War I for the French, August, which shows also that the transition from peace to war was very quick. I mean, for most families, they found out very quickly, you know, the reality of World War I. It didn't take, like, we all think of the big battles of 1916, Verdun for the French, or the Somme for the British. You know, again, August 1914, it was just like 2 or 3 weeks after the outbreak of War. These guys who see there were, most of them, actually killed in the very first weeks. Which means also that they had to be replaced, and then after the Battle of the Marne, you have many soldiers who become officers very quickly. They're trained very quickly to replace all these officers killed in the very first weeks of the conflict.
All right. Well, thank you all for
coming. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you.